Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Biology. Today we're going to explore our first kingdom in the eukarya domain, protists. This kingdom might need to come with a disclaimer though, as few topics will generate more disagreement and controversy among biologists than where these microscopic creatures should be placed in the great tree of life. We'll look at why that is in our lesson today. Before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to describe how protists are classified and give examples of each group of protists. List and describe the characteristics and adaptations of a variety of protists. It is most common today to place all unicellular or microscopic organisms that are not prokaryotes in the protist kingdom. It ends up being a bit like a miscellaneous category for all the species that don't quite fit in anywhere else. However, many scientists argue that the organisms found in this kingdom are so diverse that they should be split into many separate kingdoms. Other scientists don't feel that a protist kingdom is needed at all and would rather see these species placed within the plant, animal, or fungi kingdoms instead. This battle may not be settled anytime soon, so in the meantime, we'll study the protist kingdom as it is generally presented today in most scientific textbooks. But if you have kids at some point in the future, it's very possible that they will learn a different classification scheme for these tiniest of eukaryotes. Protists can be divided into three distinct groups based on the kingdoms they are most similar to: plant-like protists, fungus-like protists, and animal-like protists. It is thought that protists represent species closely related to the common ancestor of each of the other three kingdoms. Pause the video for a moment and in your notes, record some ideas about what you think the common ancestor of plants, fungi, and animals may have been like. As we go through the lesson, see if any of your predictions exists within the protist kingdom. The plant-like protists share a well-known trait with plants. They are autotrophs that do photosynthesis. Together, they produce about half of the world's oxygen. They are sometimes called the grasses of the seas, as they form the basis of many food chains in the oceans, and can even be found in prepared foods such as ice cream, pudding, and salad dressings. As we look at the different phyla of plant-like protists, notice that the phylum names all end with phyta, which means plant. Our first phylum, Euglenophyta, includes single-celled eukaryotes with flagella. These little speedsters are excellent swimmers, and Euglena such as these are considered to be the most animal-like of the plant-like protists. One of the most beautiful phyla of protists is the Bacillariophyta, or as they are more commonly called, diatoms. Their silica-based cell walls are similar to glass, and they form complex, intricate structures on the outside that resemble snowflakes. When large deposits of diatom fossils accumulate on the ocean floor, they form diatomaceous earth, which is a powdery substance often used in toothpaste and metal polish. Our next phylum is named after fire, the Pyrophyta, which literally translates to fire plants. More commonly known as dinoflagellates, these microscopic creatures give off light when the water they are swimming in is disturbed and can make the ocean glow in the dark. But an overgrowth of some species of dinoflagellates leads to red tide, an oceanic condition that is toxic to humans and much of the marine life in the water as well. When red tide conditions are present, you'll need to stay out of the water and avoid eating seafood that is caught from the contaminated water as well. The other phyla of plant-like protists consists of the different forms of algae. The Chrysophyta have gold chloroplasts, making these algal colonies appear yellow instead of green. Rhodophyta, the red algae group, lives deep under the ocean, thanks to their enhanced ability to collect all forms of light. Phaeophyta, or brown algae, is best known for kelp, the giant seaweed forests that fill parts of the ocean floor. In addition to absorbing carbon dioxide, which helps combat climate change, kelp forests provide food and shelter to many organisms in the ocean. Chlorophyta is the type of algae you are most familiar with, and has the characteristic green color of its plant relatives. In fact, the ancestors of plants were likely a form of chlorophyta. Most of the plant-like protists we've seen are autotrophs that live in water and can function as single-celled organisms, but they can also group together to form large colonies, like algal mats, that function a bit like multicellular organisms too. These species often blur the line between what it means to be unicellular versus multicellular, which further complicates scientists' attempts to classify them. The fungus-like protists are molds that grow in damp, nutrient-rich environments. Unlike the plant-resembling protists we looked at before, fungus-like protists are all heterotrophs, meaning they cannot do photosynthesis and must eat food. For most fungus-like protists, this means feasting on the dead and decaying organic matter found in the soil or water around them, which is exactly what we will learn to be true of actual fungi organisms. So, why aren't these species considered true fungi? It has to do with their cell wall. It lacks a key ingredient. To be considered a true fungus, the organism's cell walls must contain chitin. These species we'll look at today do not. You'll notice a pattern with the phylum names here. They all end in mycota, which means fungus. The Acrasiomycota and Myxomycota phyla are slime molds. They tend to grow in damp soil or on plants, where nutrients are readily available. They live part of their life as single-celled organisms, then later aggregate to form colonies of thousands of cells, which act as one multicellular being. The other phylum of fungus-like protists is Oomycota, also called the water molds. As the name implies, many of these species live in water and can often be seen as a white fuzz growing on dead things. However, a few species of water molds actually live on land and are parasites to plants. The most famous, or infamous, water mold is Phytophthora infestans. It was responsible for the Great Potato Famine in Ireland in 1845. Almost the entire potato crop was lost that year, thanks to the microscopic water mold. The Irish people heavily depended on a successful potato crop each year, and as a result, nearly a million people starved to death, and over a million more were forced to migrate across the ocean to the US to find work and food. Today, many US citizens of Irish ancestry can trace their family's history and arrival to America back to this fateful event. And it all started with a protist. The third category of protists are the genetic cousins of the animal kingdom, and in addition to simply being called animal-like protists, they are known as protozoans, which translates to first animals. They are all heterotrophs and are classified by how they move. You'll see as we study the individual phyla that many of these creatures, unfortunately, can be quite dangerous to humans. The Sarcodina phylum includes amoebas, which move by extending a pseudopod, or false foot. The cytoplasm is pushed into the pseudopod, and the rest of the cell simply follows. A particularly notorious Sarcodina is Nagleria fowleri, more commonly known as the brain-eating amoeba. It enters through the nose and usually occurs when swimming in contaminated lakes and rivers. It proceeds to destroy brain tissue and is almost always fatal. But not all amoebas are bad. Some are known to eat harmful bacteria in the soil through phagocytosis, a process in which the amoeba changes its shape to surround and engulf the bacterial cell, then digest it to absorb its nutrients. Phylum Mastigophora, known as the flagellates, swim using a flagella, as the name implies. One of the most well-known flagellates, Trypanosoma brucei, causes the disease African sleeping sickness. It's transferred from person to person via the tsetse fly, and is often fatal if left untreated. A less severe, though unpleasant, intestinal disease is caused by the flagellate Giardia duodenalis. You can be infected with this little parasite if you consume contaminated drinking water. The Ciliophora phylum, known for Parameciums, thankfully offers a reprieve from scary things that can kill us. These cute little creatures are harmless and even help maintain healthy ecosystems. They move by means of cilia, which are small hairs covering the outside of their cell membranes. One of the most well-known species of Ciliophora is Paramecium caudatum. Early biologists, upon seeing it under the microscope for the first time, referred to it as the slipper animalcule. The final phylum we'll look at is the sporozoa. These protists cannot move on their own and are simply carried by hosts. Most are parasites on the organisms that carry them, such as the Plasmodium malariae. Any guess which disease this one causes? Malaria. This protist infects blood cells, causing serious and sometimes fatal illness. It's transmitted through mosquito bites, so if you're in an area with known prevalence of this particular protist, you'll want to be sure to wear insect repellent. As we went through the lesson today, we looked at the three main groups of protists: plant-like, fungus-like, and animal-like. These species are as different as they are alike, which leads many scientists to question their grouping into a single kingdom. What characteristics do they share? They're all made of eukaryotic cells. They're all microscopic, unless they join with other cells to make large colonies, and most live in the water or very wet environments. And they all likely represent the early evolutionary forms of their related kingdoms. Next time, we'll take a look at the fungus kingdom. Quick poll: mushrooms, love them on a burger, or hate them? Regardless, we'll learn more about them in the next lesson. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.